Christmas. Who do you?
You got a pencil?
Sure.
There you go. Just as I thought, a stump.
Well, I like to use them right to the end. It's like eating everything on the plate.
Yes. I've got a present for you. A pencil holder. Especially for resourceful people like you.
Right? Wonderful. Hurry up then, I want to go.
Just wait a minute, wait a minute.
Candle ends. If a scrimper sees a shoelace fraying, they dip it in melted wax and the problem's over. And you could use this to grease the runners on a sticky drawer or to light a fire. Just mix sawdust and melted wax in an ordinary paper egg box, let it harden, then snap off an instant fire lighter. And a lighted candle can help you detect drafts around windows. If the flame wobbles, it's time to start draft proofing.
Seesaw is 24 people building houses for each other up on the Downs by Brighton Racecourse. 24 people escaping bedsitter land by building timber-framed houses, which, come 1995, they will be able to rent cheaply. They're learning the necessary skills as they go along, getting financial help from the local housing association and professional help when necessary. But the work, they do themselves.
So what's your job here then, Ruth?
Well, we all work on each other's houses and we all do a bit of everything, so we're all mucking in, as it were.
What's your speciality?
Cutting. Fetching, carrying and cutting.
It's been incredible. It's like nothing else you could ever do in your life. Probably everybody would think of building a house in their lifetime once, and to get the opportunity, I don't know what the percentage is, but it must be very... very small percentage, and it's the way to do it, the way we are doing it in a community, working together. It gives me more than anything of the training, the learning. That's all part of it, but the best thing is working with these people, and that's and knowing that they're the people that we'll be living with in the future. That's the best part of it, really. Like a big family.
I'd make a mess if I tried to build something. But I wouldn't mind having a go at a wigwam. I wouldn't mind living deep in the country. I wouldn't mind getting more fresh air and real fresh water. But wouldn't mind isn't good enough. Going back to living near nature is something you've got to want.
The reason we live like this is trying to be simple, trying to use only what we need.
We actually used to just sleep in the teepee in the summer, but we tried a winter and it was fine. And since then, we've just been in the teepee the whole year round, basically. Now the kids come out in the summer.
But this is Northumberland. I think they're pretty tough, these kids.
Well, it's hard, too, to get up and go to school and be clean and smart and on time and live in a teepee.
Yes, and they say on windy nights, it's like being in a sailing ship at sea. Maybe that's why this family is like a crew, a happy crew, who all know what they're doing and why.
There's two reasons. One is not taking more than you need. And one is living among nature in order for your awareness and understanding to grow. But that's different. But those are the two reasons why we're here. Do you see what I mean? They combine. But as far as you're concerned, I suppose you'd just be interested in the first, which is that, you know, you don't take from the planet more than what you need. You simply don't do it. It's the only way for us to live.
I think that probably if we had money, it would all be done. You know, we'd have solar panels for heating water, and we'd have wind generators, and we'd use it for generating electricity, but it all takes money, which we never have because we've got too many kids. They take all the money.
So what do you really like about living here? What's the best thing about it?
Nice and normal houses.
I think why? Why is it better than a normal house?
Normal houses are horrible. Like, don't look nice.
They don't look nice. So you'd rather live in a tent?
Yeah.
And of course, when people have houses, all they really want are big gardens.
Yeah.
And you've got the biggest garden in the world, haven't you?
We spent actually years with no electricity, but more and more children, more and more work, we decided that we were being a bit too harsh on ourselves.
I don't see myself as being different from anyone else. I enjoy being part of such a big family. No one's seen it as strange or... I mean, every now and again there's a joke made like, oh, they live in the teepees out on the hill, but it's nothing serious.
I read this thing about this Japanese guy once who was saying the only thing that feeds the human spirit is wilderness. And I think he's right. To live in an open way, you need wilderness.
When it used to be a proper mining community, when the pits were open, everybody used to look out for each other. Well, when we hit our hard times, I sort of like get vexed and I think it shouldn't be like this. We've got all this time on our hands and we should get out there and do something to make money. We shouldn't be sitting around moping about it because you can't do that.
Susan Simpson grew up hearing stories of how tough things had been in the Northeast in the 30s and 40s. But then there was always the prospect of a revival in the demand for coal. Now there's only the Simpson family's determination to do something.
I'm always trying something new to see if I can help the house budget. I've tried quite a few things. We've tried auctions, car boot sales, you know. We've tried... I had a fish and chip trailer at one time, and I tried that, and that didn't appear, so we got rid of that. Well, we've tried all sorts of things, and I'm going to try with my plants in the greenhouse before long and see how that comes out, you know. So coal is the one that's appeared the best, really, you know. Bought the tractor, second-hand tractor. I mean, it's an old thing, but it does the job, and I can get 12 bags in, you know. So if I go down there once a fortnight, it keeps my two fires going. If there's any spare, I'll sell it off to the neighbours, you know. So it helps me, it helps run the tractor, and, you know, the house is always warm. There's a lot of people say there's a seam under the seabed, and every time there's a high sea, it breaks the seam and fetches coal onto the shore. And there's coal in the cliff, there's a seam about a foot high, and as the sea erodes the cliff away and it falls into the sea, we get that coal as well, you know. So even if the colliery does close permanently, there'll still be sea coal down there for a few years.
I like the front.
Thank you. Since I was born here, I suppose I can say thank you, but it is only a front. There are people who live here as well.
That pier's taken a bit of a hammering.
Yeah, well, the whole place has. These hotels only survive because of conferences. I remember a time when the seafront was so crowded you could hardly walk along it, but not now.
So what do scrimpers do at the seaside?
Who knows?
Every day I go down the hill, about 5 minutes walk, and there's an open market which has pretty well everything I need. Fruit and veg, eggs, yesterday's bread. Also, they have these little sort of baskets at the back of the shops where they have bundles of things for only 10p and that sort of thing. Vegetables, which make excellent soup, and fruit, which I can stew. I live very well, and I'm very healthy. What else? Eggs much cheaper, cheese cheaper, and sometimes the cracked eggs, which is cheaper still. You have to be up pretty bright and early to get those sort of treasures, yes.
There aren't many short level walks in Brighton, so Mary Pook keeps her knees working with 20 minutes Tai Chi every day. Her methodical ways helped her bring up her children on her own, and those habits certainly help her now. She knows her pensioner's rights, about coupons and competitions, about what concessions she can get on fairs, and the free courses the university's running.
I noticed in your bathroom, Mary, you've got lots and lots of toilet rolls. Now, what's that?
Well, I want a year's supply of toilet rolls. In coupons, I may say, not in kind. So I get them in fours as I need them. I started doing competitions because I found, although I could feed the children adequately and I could clothe them from jumble sales, when it came to birthday Christmas presents. I didn't have any spare cash. So I had to win those sort of things. So I started from soft toys, as it were, and gradually progressed as they needed things, up to transistors and bikes and so forth, as they got bigger and bigger. And now, of course, they nag me for cars, which I can't get.
What are the children doing now?
Gerard has been a trained dancer, and his second study was clarinet, so he's also a professional clarinetist, and he busks.
I think the way that our mother brought us up gave us this confidence and independence so that we were never abashed at going out and bestowing our talent upon the world, no matter how big or small it is, but at least it's a talent. I collected for the Boy Scouts and for UNICEF and Oxfam. I always got a good reaction knocking on people's doors. I suppose it's transposed into the fact that although I'm a musician primarily, I do also entertain the public as a busker. There has to be a certain amount of confidence to do that. It's the difference between knocking on people's doors as opposed to knocking on their souls.
I'll do the loo roll scrimp, shall I?
Sure, go ahead.
Very simple, this. Before you put the roll on the spindle, you squash it like that, or even tread on it. Then you put it on the spindle like that, and now it grips. So teenagers, those terrible teenagers, can't rip off 17 sheets at a time. See? It holds. Sort of hold, look. That's good, isn't it?
And that idea comes from Mrs. Mary Fedorka of Jamestown, New York, writing in the Tightwad Gazette, which is part of a growing pile of American publications about scrimping and scraping. This is international.
What do you do with these film canisters? I mean, they're beautifully made, but I mean, what other uses could you find for them?
Pins, fuses, small precious things, or shampoo. Actually, I use them when I'm collecting seeds in gardens and hedgerows. And I label them, because the label is the scrimper's best friend.
Well, tell you what I could do. I could put a spare door key in this, bury it in the front garden, and then I'd never get locked out again.
Right. Unless you forgot where you buried it.
Don't be silly.
Meanwhile, strange preparations are underway in Birmingham. It's the travelling players.
In about a week's time, this is going to be a theatrical structure touring the UK around the festival scene.
Julian paints circus wagons for a living.
Where'd you get this lorry?
It was military originally.
Yeah.
And then it was bought by a lighting company, and they didn't really find a use for it. So I got it cheap from them.
What, and you drive this, do you?
I do, yes.
Has it got power steering?
No.
And the crane?
The crane came from a car scrapyard.
Yeah.
And it was in the hedge in the car scrapyard.
Oh.
And nothing worked on it. I had to sort of pretty much rebuild it.
And this box is your home, is it?
Yes, it is. This was... The box itself came out of a field that was... it was actually being a Shetland pony stable at the time. And the windows are from a caravan. The steels come from an old grain silo with a framework around an old grain silo.
Is it small inside as it is out?
No, it's huge inside. It's a TARDIS.
Is it? Oh. What's the ladder for? Can you come like that?
Come on in.
What do you use this for?
Pretty much everything.
Oh. Oh. It's wonderful. It's so small.
Yeah, it is a little small, actually.
Well, now, tell us, this is the bed?
Yeah.
Right, now, what's that made out of?
This is all made out of floorboards.
Really?
Sort of.
Comfortable?
Yeah, it is, actually. It's got a foam base.
Is it a sort of hobby, all this, or do you do it because you have to do it, or you like doing it, or what?
It's... I mean, I see things, and I think... And they've been thrown away, or they're in a skip, or whatever, and I think, well, I can make a use out of them. That's
so, in other words, they're dead when they're thrown away, and you bring them back to life.
Yeah, I'd try to make some use of them. Ooh. And also, obviously, it's definitely cheaper for me to make use of things that other people have thrown away.
Than... What's this dresser thing you've got here?
The dresser itself is actually an old Irish dresser. I've put new shelves in from bits of wood out of skips and whatever, and old sweet jars. The stove came from an auction. It was all bashed up at the back. And I got a friend to kind of put it back together. And there's a lot of cement in it all over, holding it together. The pipe is off a drive shaft off a lorry. It's just the right bore, you know, it's just the right size.
Was that thrown away as well?
Well, that was from a scrapyard.
Good. So all this stuff you found on skips or you bought secondhand, so that's in a way it's all sort of thrown out. Yeah. And what you've done is got hold of it and made it all work in your little house.
Packaging's been getting a really bad name, but it's a fact of modern life. It does give scrimpers plenty of things to reuse, like mesh bags from the supermarket. You can use them as delicate scourers, you can hang bulbs out in the shed to dry, you can hang the kids' bath toys up to dry in these. And if you want to peel tomatoes, pop them in here, dunk them in boiling water for half a minute, and they'll peel a treat.
What about soap in the shower?
Yeah, very nice.
Thanks, Rick.
Now that Laura Howard's retired, she's her own jobbing builder. I just wish when she's picking up heavy weights, she'd do it properly and bend her knees.
I was born in the country and I just always liked down this way anyway and came here. I would have liked to have got a little cottage set in its own grounds and that, but the time I came down, there was that time of the property boom and... Well, the place I had in mind would have cost me twice as much as what I had.
You and I might be tickled pink if this was where we retired to. But not Laura. She said about changing it. Devon's got plenty of rough stone, and Laura's got her son to do the lighter work.
I just can't afford to employ anybody to do everything. Also, I firmly believe that anybody can do anything if they really put their mind to it. There's plenty of manuals about, and you learn by mistakes. I mainly have to watch someone do something maybe once or twice, and I get the hang of it and have a go at it myself, and why not do it right the first time? But it hadn't cost me anything. If the wood's been scrounged or whatever, I'd just have a go at it.
Just give us that piece, that big piece with the split in it, Ray.
Oh, all right. I'm a squirrel, as much as a scrimper. I hoard things, something's got to be absolutely useless for me to throw away. I started off doing it for economy, but now it's not as much as economy as the fact that I like doing it and I get satisfaction.
You've got to let the saw do the work here, you don't have to work yourself too hard.
And I just stand back and I say, oh, that only cost me a couple of bob or something like that. I've done all that and it's cost me practically nothing except the cheek to go round scavenging.
Well done, Laura. Do you want a hand, Lou?
No, it's okay, Ray. I can manage, thanks.
If you've got an active mind and you've got a pair of hands and you're on the end of your arms that you can use, there's no need for anybody to sit about and rot. You've got to keep occupied. It might help a bit more if you've got yourself a timetable, but I had timetables for 30-odd years and I don't carry a watch. Every second of my working life was governed by the watch. I don't... 33 years of bus work, that's enough.
My mum used to work on the buses in Brighton.
Brighton?
Yeah, used to be called a clippy. Were you a clippy?
Yeah, that's what they call us, yeah. And among other things...
I bought this off a homeless guy in New York. It's a candle holder, little lantern. Takes the top out, slits it down the side, squashes it a bit, and then sells it.
Yeah, it's resourceful. Canny.
Yeah, well, he makes a living out of empty cans, showing once again that recycling works best when someone's making money out of it.
Yeah.
Whizzing along, you don't see things unless they're colourful. You certainly see the cans that James Bidherney plans to pay his mortgage with.
How's your campaign going?
Not all neighbours are approved, but my immediate neighbours are very helpful. And he was saying, James, I wouldn't worry about what you think, what we think, or what the distant neighbours think. It's what the publics think. And he said, there's your proof out there. Mind you, they did say that it was a bit of an eyesore, so I gift-wrapped it. represents £4 cash.
You can seem to have taken over your entire life, your house and your garden.
My bathroom's overflowing, literally, because I haven't got a hot water system, so I thought it was a good use for a bath.
What inspired you to start collecting cans?
Well, it's funny, but when you're faced with a litigation notice that says in so many weeks you've got to come up with thousands of pounds and you haven't got it, you think, well, how can I forestall that demand? And I happened to have a windowsill with about a half a dozen cans on it. And there was one can there, a ginger beer can, that had three little boys on it. And I thought, that's me in the 1930s, you know, the Canadian Depression. And somebody gave me a wagon when I was a small boy, and my grandfather seized on it. And he said, come on, we're going to go and collect bottles, which is the equivalent of the aluminium can today. And we used to go out of the city limits and pick up various bottles along the country road, and we'd take them home and wash them out in the tin tub. And then on Saturday mornings, that was the big day, we'd take them down to the local repository, and the reward was a triple ice cream cone for me and Granddad, where he'd get his big tin of tobacco.
Where will you take all these cans?
They just recently opened a recycling plant in Acton, not far from me.
What kind of people are bringing in the cans?
It's a wide diversity of people. I mean, it's everybody from Boy Scouts to Hell's Angels, really. We've had particular individual collectors, one guy down on the south coast who's collected money to pay for his two daughters' weddings, for example.
How do you recommend that people set up a recycling scheme?
Well, the first thing to do is decide on what your objective's going to be. That's the key. Secondly, get your friends and your colleagues involved as well. The next step is to contact, particularly if you want to make serious money out of it, is to contact people who actually use the cans, the places where the cans are going to be lying around.
There are serious energy savings, aren't there, for you as manufacturers?
Sure. I mean, recycling an aluminium can will save about 95% of the energy that it would cost to produce a can from new, if you like. So from that point of view alone, it's well worth doing.
And are there still enough cans for every collector out there?
Every year, every person in the UK gets through just over 100 aluminium drinks cans. That means there are 6 billion cans lying around the streets, parks and canteens of this country.
It's a lot of kilos, a lot of money.
A lot of money. Around about £50 million could be raised each year if people were only to get organised and actually collect all those cans that are used.
Thank you very much.
Thrifty 50. 50 ideas to help you scrimp. For a copy, send a postal order or cheque for £2 made out to Channel 4 to Scrimpers, PO Box 4000, London W3 6XJ. Waste of want not, that's what they'll say. Waste not, want not, don't throw.
Click on screen for more videos of extraordinary humans.